The following is an excerpt from the Octane Master Course, which is the first fully comprehensive series of video tutorials for Octane Render in Cinema 4D. It's meant for all skill levels and will cover everything you've ever wanted to know about Octane and how it interacts with Cinema 4D. This course will also continue to evolve and update as Octane and Cinema 4D change over the years. If you would like more information on the Octane Master Course and where to buy it, check the link below. Hello everybody and welcome back. In this video we're going to be learning about the Gaussian spectrum node inside Cinema 4D and Octane Render. Now, as per usual, before we begin, I just want to talk very lightly about the scene setup I have here. I'm using an infinite floor object as my floor, a sphere as my object with its segment set to 60, and an octane daylight object with a torpidity of 3 and a sun size of 30 to light my scene, along with my kernel set to path tracing. We're also underneath the Octane node editor layout, and I've created an Octane diffuse material default and just slapped it on my sphere right here. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and hop over to our Octane node editor, and let's begin by talking about how do we create the Gaussian spectrum node. Well, there's one of three ways you can do this. The first way is we just go up to our list here by holding down the middle mouse button and pulling up and down until we find our Gaussian spectrum here, which is underneath the textures panel. Let's go ahead and take this Gaussian spectrum and pull him out. Now, the second way that we can create him is by right-clicking, going to texture, going to Gaussian spectrum, or finally, the third way is searching G-A-U-S, Gaussian. There you go. Gaussian is in the list. Middle mouse button to pull up and down if it bugs out. So we can middle mouse pull down to get it from bugging out and pull down if it gets stuck up here. And we can just go ahead and pull him out from the list as well. Let's go ahead and remove him from the search and remove these two from the search as well. I'm going to press delete to remove those, not backspace. Go ahead and press render to start up your render. And I accidentally deleted my Octane Sky, so I'm just going to undo that. There we go. Our Octane Sky is now back, and it is alive. So now that we have everything set up and we are good to go, let's go ahead and begin by first talking about what is the Gaussian spectrum. Well, to really make it apparent about what it does, let's just go ahead and take it and plug it into our diffuse port on our diffuse material. Now, the Gaussian spectrum is very similar to the RGB spectrum, which is something we learned about in a previous video. Now, if you skipped it, I will lightly mention that the RGB spectrum is simply a red, green, or blue RGB node that you can use to create a color. So it's simply a color node that you can make any color you would like and then pump that into any one of these ports. For example, we can make a nice green color with the RGB spectrum. The Gaussian spectrum does the exact same thing, except it does it a little bit differently. If we select our Gaussian spectrum, you'll notice instead of looking at hue, saturation, vibrance, or an RGB color palette, we are looking at something very, very different. We're looking at wavelength, width, and power. Now, this is something you're probably not very familiar with. So to help describe what's going on here, I'm going to go ahead and pull up a web page made by this guy named InfraThrills Design. This guy is incredible. He has some incredible stuff. Highly recommend checking him out. It's just InfraThrill.com. You can see this is his website up here. Highly recommend checking him out. He's a super big helper in learning about Octane, and really recommend giving this guy's stuff a look because he is a really great resource to keep in mind. But the reason I'm referring you to this page is because if we scroll down this list to this spot right here, he has this beautiful diagram that shows the difference in wavelength and frequencies in something called a visible spectrum. Now, to really understand what this visible spectrum is, I need to first mention that Octane Render is a spectral render engine. This means it is extremely realistic because the light we see in real life is spectral rays. So Octane is copying that same design. It's based on the same principles of real life. This is really important because it means Octane has extremely realistic looking renders. Now, there is a drawback to this. Instead of like other render engines and other typical color palettes you're probably used to working to, where you got just red, green, or blue, and you just kind of mix between the hue, saturation, and vibrance of those, Octane doesn't do that by default. By default, it runs under this spectral system here, the spectral rays. Now, the spectral ray system, like in real life, is not based off of red, green, or blue, but it's based off of a wavelength of the actual light spectrum. Now, in life, we have a ton of different visible wavelengths in spectrums, and some of which are not visible. For example, we have IR here, which is a higher wavelength, and this is called infrared. This is infrared light that we cannot see with our bare eyes. On reversely, if we go down in our spectrum, we have UV light, which is actually tighter, closer wavelengths. And this is light, this is called ultraviolet rays, and these rays are also incapable to be seen by the human eye. And then we have, of course, X-rays, and then we have at the very bottom, we have just plain rays. Now, what's interesting, though, is between UV and infrared rays, we have the visible spectrum of light. What's very interesting here is this small little area of this entire frequency of the light spectrum is actually our entire red, green, and blue rainbow effect. So this little spot right here is our entire visible spectrum of light. Now, towards the top of our spectrum in this tiny little segment, we have the 700 wavelength area, and this is where we have red light. Now, if we go all the way down, we're going to come into orange, yellow, green, light blue, darker blue, and then finally end with purple. So this is how the entire spectrum of light and colors that we see around us in our day-to-day experience is what it is made out of. Now, of course, if all these light rays are combined together in one gigantic ray of light, they are basically pure white light. That's what regular sunlight looks like. Now that we understand this, let's go ahead and talk about how does this correspond to Octane's Gaussian spectrum node. Since this node is running under that exact same principle, we can determine our wavelength determines where are we searching in the spectrum. Because remember, a different wavelength determines a different color, right? Up here in the 700 wavelength zone, we have red, but down here in the 400 wavelength zone, we have purple. Now, it's very important to note that the range is actually, for visible light that we can see, is actually 380 to 720 nanometers. That's what it's measured in. It's something called a nanometer. I'm not exactly sure how big that is, but just take my word for it. That's what these numbers are referring to. Now, Octane, on the other hand, is using a 0-to-1 ratio to express these distances. So just realize when Octane has 1 punched in, that's equal to 700 nanometers, and when it has 0 punched in, that's equal to 380 nanometers. That can be a little complicated, but don't really worry about that. All you're going to be really doing is just pulling sliders until things look good. That's about what I do anyway. So, now that we understand this, let's go ahead and talk about this width slot. So now that we know that wavelength is associated with where are we looking in the spectrum, just try and view wavelength as basically your hue, what color. Then width is determining saturation, how bright or how focused do we want to be on that color. And finally, power is represented of power, brightness, or lightness to that image. So if I were to adjust my wavelength slider, I'm going to pick where in the spectrum I would like to have color. So let's just go ahead and say right now we want to have like a kind of blue color right towards the bottom of the spectrum. All I'm going to do is I'm just going to pull this slider down, my wavelength, until we get a nice blue color. And lo and behold, here it is, a blue color is showing up. Next up, I want to intensify this blue color. So now we're down in the spectrum. If I take my width and increase that, that's our saturation value, kind of, we're going to increase the width of it. How wide of a spectrum are we going to be looking through? If I crank this all the way up to 1, we are always going to get pure white. That's because when all the colors of the rainbow are incorporated into one, we basically get pure white light. It's only when we separate them off through like a refraction process or through like a prism can we see each individual colored ray. So if I were to pull this width down so we could focus on just those blue aspects of that ray, we're going to pull it down tighter and tighter. Now that we have a small enough width, we are now getting a very intense and pretty blue color. Now, it's very important to be aware that this is not how you'd normally think when it comes to adjusting this as a saturation slider, because normally higher saturation would mean more color, but it's actually the opposite. We're going to just pure white where we lose all that color. So we want to definitely pull this down to a much tighter spectrum to give us that high color. So don't view it exactly as hue, saturation, and lightness. Just kind of use this as like some guidelines. This is not 100% scientifically correct, but just kind of it's a good kind of base point to view it as. So now that we understand that, and we kind of know what the width does, let's go ahead and finally finish up with power, which again is simply lightness, right? This is just determines the brightness of our image. So if I go ahead and turn this down, we lose all the intensity of that light till eventually we lose everything. It just goes to pure black. And if I pull it all the way up to 1, then it's basically the pure whatever color we happen to pick. Now, we're getting to the part of this course where you're going to be wanting to ask the question, why the heck would we use the Gaussian spectrum? I just want to go ahead and pick whatever color I want. Say I plug this in here. I just want to have it look green, or I want to have it look yellow or red or blue. Why do I need to go through this way? This is so counterintuitive. Why would I go around picking my colors that way? This is a very good question, and there's one very good, very big answer for that. In most cases, you are not going to need to use the Gaussian spectrum, and I don't recommend using the Gaussian spectrum. In almost every case, the RGB spectrum is just a whole lot easier and faster. There is some very specific cases, though, when the Gaussian spectrum is going to be quite, in fact, 100% required to do some certain effects correctly, such as using the Gaussian spectrum versus the RGB spectrum to change the color of lights that you're emitting from the surface of an object. Now, to make this very clear, what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold down the middle mouse button. I'm going to move my palette up here. I'm going to go ahead and pull out something called a texture emission node. That's underneath the emission tab right here. I'm just going to pull this out. Now, we haven't talked about texture emission nodes yet, so if you don't know what's going on here, that's okay. All we need to focus on is that there is a power slider in here. This simply determines the brightness of our light. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this texture emission node and I'm going to plug it into the emission slot of our diffuse material. When I do this, it'll allow my sphere here that has this texture on it to emit light just like any other light you would put into Octane. So it's now 100% fully realistic visible light in my scene right here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this Gaussian spectrum right here and I'm going to plug it in to my texture slot. This will change the color of my light to emit the color that my Gaussian spectrum is set to. And you can see we're emitting blue light into our scene right now. You're probably thinking, oh, okay, that's pretty great. Couldn't I just use the RGB spectrum for this? And the answer is yes, you could. So let's go ahead and plug that in. There is some drawbacks, though. Let's go ahead and set our RGB spectrum to something like pure red. And we're going to crank every value up to as high as we can. Now, most programs like Octane Render don't like 100% pure values. They don't like 100% pure red because that can have some issues and glitches that can happen. For example, right now everything looks fine, but as I take my power and start to crank it up, look and see what's starting to happen right here. We are getting purple light mixed into our red light. This is because the RGB spectrum is running under a red, green, and blue algorithm. Now, remember how we are talking about Octane is a spectral render engine, right? It runs under a spectral system of light and color, just like we were viewing in this diagram. That means every form of color in Octane runs under that spectrum. That means this RGB spectrum, even though it's running under a red, green, and blue system, must be converted over to that Gaussian spectrum system before it can show up in your render. So this gives you the controls and the tools to adjust your colors in an RGB type system, but it is not going to be outputted that way. It's going to be outputted as a Gaussian spectrum, so it must be converted. Now, sadly, the conversion process between an RGB spectrum and a Gaussian spectrum is not perfect. There's going to be a few errors and mix-ups. It's not always going to give you that correct color. And in this case, you can see it's giving us a little bit of a purple tint. So there's a few purple highlights that are kind of showing up in this Gaussian spectrum that are showing up in our render here. Now, just to really make sure and kind of really hammer this home that this is coming from our RGB spectrum, I'm going to turn off my Octane Daylight object because Octane is very realistic. It mixes colors together, even colors of light. So the light we're getting from our sky is going to affect the light that we're getting on our ground from the sphere here. So let's go ahead and turn off our Daylight object. And lo and behold, it did affect and change that color there. This said, though, you can see we're getting a very strange effect on our sphere here. We're getting purple and yellow showing up. Again, this is because of those imperfections and variations from that calculation between the RGB spectrum and to the Gaussian spectrum running through this texture emission node. Now, I'm going to go ahead and turn on surface brightness. I'm not going to talk too much about what this does. Just be aware it can make your lighting more even and a little bit more brighter. So when I turn that on, we're going to be learning about him more later underneath the texture emission node. But now that I have turned that on, you can see that we are definitely getting a purplish yellow tint on our sphere here. And even as I create a render region and try and render this out, it's just not happening, right? This is not being fixed. This is imperfections in our lighting that just kind of happen to be forced to be shown out. So, can we fix this with the Gaussian spectrum node? That is the big question. The answer is yes, we can. Let's go ahead and do that right now. Let's go ahead and take our Gaussian spectrum, plug it into the texture slot, and now we're getting blue light because that's what we set it to. Let's go ahead and move over to our handy little palette here and go ahead and figure what color we're after. What I want is a red light. So we're talking at the higher 700 nanometer spectrum of the scale here, and that is going to be running under a value more close to 1, right? The opposite end of blue. So let's go ahead and grab our wavelength and pull this up to something kind of big, like say 0.8, right? That should be pretty high up there. Now that we've done that, now we need to dial in the intensity, the depth of our rays, the width of our rays, right? How far are we going to search in this box? Are we going to make it a very wide search where we're going to incorporate a lot of different wavelengths, or very tight and only very certain wavelengths? Let's go ahead and do that now. Let's bring our wavelength even smaller. And as we get down all the way to 0.02, we finally are getting our pure red light. Now, in this particular case, he is actually recommending in this video a wavelength of 0.75 and a width of 0.015. So we could go ahead and type that in. We'll just say a wavelength of 0.75 and a width of 0.015. And that gives us this pure red like he shows in this image right here. Now, what's so great about this is we can take our texture emission and we can pull this down and we can crank it up, and no matter what, we're always going to keep that red color. Whereas if we plugged our RGB spectrum into this slot here, we keep our red color when our light is somewhat dark, but as we crank its brightness up, you can see what's happening here. We lose that effect entirely and we start getting like this yellow hue in here and this purple hue, and it just is not being calculated right. So it's very important to stick with that Gaussian spectrum, especially if you're trying to adjust the colors of your lights, especially on mesh objects. Now, this said, if we're going to use it on a diffuse material, let's go ahead and turn our sky back on, it doesn't really matter. Whether you plug your Gaussian spectrum in here for your red, or you plug in your RGB spectrum in here, you can get about the same colors, and it's just a whole lot easier using your RGB spectrum to adjust your colors that way, instead of having to work with this Gaussian spectrum. So in most cases, you will be sticking with this RGB spectrum, but if specifically if you're working with your texture emission node and using it to create light, you definitely want to run a Gaussian spectrum under here. Now I want to point out, notice this heavy purple I'm getting on the edge here. This again is because we are mixing the light from this sphere here with our Octane sky. What's so powerful about this Gaussian spectrum, unlike the RGB spectrum, right? Instead of being stuck with that, what we can do is we can incorporate some more rays into our scene to help offset that purple color. Now, what's very interesting is because we're up towards the high end of this spectrum, what Octane does, and this is not what happens in real life, as you go past 700, you basically lose what the human eye can see. But in Octane, as you go past 700, it actually loops back around and pulls in some of these colors. So as I go too high on this spectrum, we're going to be incorporating in some of that purple color. So what we can do is we need to pull away the height of our spectrum and pull away some of that color from the purple, which would mean to induce a little bit more of this yellow or orange color. So to do this, all I have to do is hop into my Gaussian spectrum and lower my wavelength, bring myself lower on that board. Let's go ahead and back away from the red, which is clipping over into the purple, looping back around, and bring us down something a little lower. Let's go ahead and try a value of something like 0.6. Now 0.6 has definitely got rid of that purple color, but now we're too far yellow. So let's go ahead and up ourselves, maybe 0.65. 0.65 is kind of close, but still giving us that same issue. 0.68, and 0.68 is showing up a little red. Let's go ahead and up this maybe to 0.7 on the dot. And at 0.7 on the dot, we are incorporating a much more reddish color, but a little bit of purple. So let's go ahead and lower him to something like 0.69. Now, at 0.69, we are just barely touching into that yellow. Let's try 0.695. And at 0.695, we are close. 0.69, say 8. 0.698. We're still getting a little too much purple. Let's go 0.695, back down again. That's killing off the purple. At this point, it's something that I'm pretty happy with, especially with the mix of that light there. So I really just want to point out how the Gaussian spectrum allows us to pull away from that purplish color that was showing up and much more easily change the lighting of our scene. So being aware of this workflow is very important, especially when you're working with lights here. If we were trying to do this with the RGB spectrum, it would be a nightmare. We'd be trying to pull away from it, and we just were blowing out our yellows here. It's just getting way too bright. It's just not going to mix very well. So you're definitely better off working with that Gaussian spectrum, because you're going to lose that red instantly, and you're not going to be able to get rid of that purple, as you can see here. Just too many issues arise from that. So again, highly recommend keeping with the Gaussian spectrum, especially in this case here. But at this point, this video is done. Thank you so much for watching. I am going to finish up with a very, very light recap of what we just learned, and then I will end the video. But in this video, we learned how to create something called the Gaussian spectrum. We learned that the Gaussian spectrum is very similar to the RGB spectrum in that it's used to create color inputs to our materials and other nodes, except we learned that instead of the RGB spectrum, unlike the RGB spectrum, where you would run underneath a hue, saturation, and vibrance RGB system, we're going to run under a Gaussian spectral system, which is underneath the spectrum system, which is how real life is calculated, and it's exactly how Octane calculates life as well, because Octane is a spectral render engine. We learned that this doesn't really mean anything if you're going to be pumping anything into diffuse colors or basically any other color parameter, and we learned that you can go ahead and use that RGB spectrum as much as you want with really out any issues. We did learn, though, that there was a certain few cases, like plugging in our RGB spectrum into our texture emission node to make light on our diffuse material. We learned that this can have issues and errors show up, like with bright red colors and stuff, when you crank your light so high that the calculation conversion between an RGB node to the Gaussian spectrum, like you have to do because Octane only calculates Gaussian spectrum colors in that wavelength, like we weren't learned about over here, was something that can give errors. There's errors between calculating between him and then going into here. So the moral of this whole talk is get rid of the middleman, get rid of this guy up here, go straight to him, the source of the color, and pump it into the texture emission, and then you can control that color, control what part of that spectrum you're going to get instead of having those errors in that calculation, and make it so you can get that pure red color that you're after, even in this bright sunlight. So with the light off, we're getting our nice pure red, and even with that light mixing on, we can still kind of help fight that color change and keep that pure red going for us. Again, thank you so much. I really hope you found this video helpful. I know the Gaussian spectrum node was a very overwhelming thing to learn. It was for me too when I first tried learning about it. So I thank you so much again for watching. Again, I hope you found this helpful, and I cannot wait to see you all in the next video.